Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Yeah, I was making a second video. The secret to receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Like I said, I'm going to preach because the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach. Thank the Lord, because I love to preach and I don't really like to teach so much. But I will do videos teaching, and I have done videos. If you're looking for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you want to know if you're saved or not, you want to know if you're going to go in the rapture or not, I've got lots of videos. If you go to my channel, you can do a search or whatever. Look for those videos on those topics. The number one question that people ask me is, how do I know if I'm saved or not? I just made a video this before this about that. Secret to knowing you're saved is what it's going to be called. So this is going to be called Secret to How to Receive the Baptism of the Holy Spirit. You could also call it Secret How to Be Healed and all that kind of stuff. So instead of teaching, I want to preach about it. So this is something that the Lord was just showing me. I was just praying before I started the last video, and the Lord was just reminding me. You know, there's a song called These Are the Days of Elijah. And when I was going to Bible college through Assemblies of God, I was an altar worker at Assemblies of God Church. And they used to have pretty good praise and worship there. And anyway, they started singing that song, These Are the Days of Elijah. And when I'm doing praise and worship, I usually am singing along. I close my eyes. I intercede. I pray. I intercede. Sometimes the Lord will have me, because this church is a big church. It holds like 4,000 people, 5,000. The Lord would have me pray, even though I usually sit near the front as an altar worker. But I would pray for somebody. Like if I'd see somebody come in, the Lord would burden my heart to pray for them. And I'd pray for them during the praise and worship until they would go to the altar. Seen it many, many times. Lots of you who know how to pray, you know what I'm talking about. Get the Holy Spirit to get a hold of somebody by praying for them fervently during the praise and worship. But anyway, during the praise and worship, I had my eyes closed, worshiping the Lord. That's the problem with lots of churches. A lot of people, they haven't been filled with the Holy Spirit and all that. Lots of times it's because people keep peeping around, looking around, seeing what everybody else is doing. You know, I have lots of these religious people that, you know, that I know, and they didn't know that I'm a Spirit-filled Christian. I mean, you know, Spirit-filled. I mean, Spirit-baptized, Spirit-filled, you know, a full gospel preacher. Preach the full gospel, not just part of the gospel, but the whole thing. And I was talking to them, and you know, and I just kind of see what they're going to say. And I've had lots of these denominational preachers tell me, yeah, I went and visited that Assemblies of God, and the people in there, I looked around, they keep raising their hands, and singing with joy and all them. They don't respect God. I don't know what's wrong with them. And this is the kind of comments they say. And so the question is, why are you looking around? Why didn't you read the Bible verse where Paul said, I would have all men everywhere raising holy hands to heaven, you know, praising God? They're too busy looking what everybody else is doing instead of seeking the Lord. That's the problem with most people. They love to make these videos. I see these videos people posting where there's worship in the church. And like the Lord led me to make a video of the World Harvest Revival Church in Kansas City, Missouri, and the Lord told me He was well pleased with those people, and those are His children. And I made a video about that maybe a few weeks ago, and as the Lord had led me, of course, I already know that from my own experience. That's what the Lord loves, when we worship Him and call upon His name, and not be worried what other people think. See, lots of people become religious. They think, ooh, they're being solemn. The real deal is they're afraid of what other people's going to think. They're worried about man. They're man pleasers. They're wearing a mask. When people really worship the Lord in spirit and in truth and fervently, the Bible says in James chapter 5 that the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. It accomplishes a lot when you fervently pray. So when you fervently pray, and you can't worry about what other people think. You know, you got to be wide open. That's when I make my videos. I'm never a people pleaser. By the grace of God, may I never be a people pleaser. May I never be worried about what people think. When I was in the States, there was particularly one, but actually it was two or three, that really pressured me to compromise and, you know, kiss up to them and all this, insinuating that they would donate to Joshua's ministry, insinuating. And I was like kind of getting into it, but, you know, I was checked in my spirit by the Lord. No, God provides. God will always provide. The Bible says, except the Lord build the house, those that labor in vain. If I wanted to kiss up to people and kiss their backside, their blessed assurance to get Joshua's ministry done, I would be just like all 99% of the churches in the world today. That's what they did. They're kissing up to people that's got some means to support their ministry, and they say what the people want to hear. I mean, that's what all this religion came from tares, weeds, the devil's children, with the world's money, controlling weak-minded, weak, lack of faith preachers. That's where all these denominations came from. So you want to know the secret of being baptized in the Holy Spirit? You want to know the secret of how to get healed? Let's, you know, we can go to all the Bible verses and all that. Lots of you already know that. By His stripes we were healed, the Bible tells us. 2 Peter 2:14 in Isaiah 53 it says, by His stripes we are healed. Then in the New Testament we were healed. In Peter he says, by His stripes we were healed. You could read where Jesus in Matthew 8:6-17 it says, you know, Jesus healed all their sickness and all of our diseases. He went around healing all the sick. Talks about in Acts where when Peter's talking to Cornelius, that he went around healing all that were sick. So there's tons of Bible verses. You could go on and on and on about healing. You could go on and on and on about the baptism of the Holy Spirit with Bible verses, with the evidence of speaking in tongues. I've done lots of videos on that. Search my channel about how that being baptized in the Holy Spirit is separate from salvation. And when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, the initial evidence is speaking in tongues and prophesying. As a matter of fact, it says to speak in tongues and to prophesy, bringing glory to God. So let's go to preaching about that. Now, in that church that I was an altar worker in, Assemblies of God Church, like I talked about, very similar to the worship that you see from the World Harvest Revival Church, like the video that I posted, gave a link to one of their videos. You can go look it up, their praise and worship, as an example of a real manifestation of the church in praise and worship. You know, talking about their preaching, I never even watched their preaching hardly at all. Just a little bit, my internet's kind of slow here, but the praise and worship is right on time with God's will. Anyway, so during the praise and worship of that song, these are the days of Elijah. And it gets to the end of the song, and I had my eyes closed, and I was, you know, worshiping the Lord. And then it says, there's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. They start repeating that a few times. And I saw a vision, brothers and sisters. What I already knew, but I saw a vision of it. I saw as if the Father was sitting on the throne. And as soon as we started saying, there's no God like Jehovah, there's no God like Jehovah, as if God put His hand like this and telling like the heavenly host to be quiet, telling those angels and all the people in heaven to be quiet with this hand. You can't see me. Like this. Waved His arm like this to the people, like be quiet in heaven. And then He put His hand to His ear and just leaned right over. And it was like He was leaning over the balcony of heaven. He was on His throne, but leaning over as if He was sticking His ear over the balcony of heaven into the earth and listening to us singing, and then a smile on His face. That was in 2003 when I had that vision in the church. And God was well pleased with what was going on. There's no God like Jehovah. So it's like this, brothers and sisters. One time when I was making videos, the Lord led me to sing a little bit. And I'm not really much of a singer. But when I sing, the power of God moves. And that's why God would have me sing sometimes to be used as an instrument. Because the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of His people. So everything I do, hopefully, by the grace of God, is by Bible verses. Lots of people not knowing the Bible, you know, these denominational people spout in their mouth. They don't even know what the Word of God says. So don't, you need to read the Word of God. I have to say that every video. So, because you got to. You got to read the Word yourself and not have secondhand faith and not go by what other people say. What I'm giving you is the tools of how to understand the Bible, how to see what it says, how to know how to have that relationship with God that you want to have. If you want to have a relationship with God, if you don't want to have a relationship with God and you say, if I say, hey, are you a Christian? I'm a Baptist. Oh, I'm a Catholic. Oh, I'm a Methodist. Okay. You want to be religious? You want to be part of a social clique and an order and a, you know, like a Masonic lodge? It's kind of like that. You want to be part of a lodge, a group? Go for it. But if you want to be a follower of Jesus, when people ask me, what are you? Oh, I'm a born-again Christian. I'm a Christian, which means follower of Christ. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. Oh, I don't start spouting off about denominations. That's all of the devil's division in the body of Christ. The devil, through his tares, through his weeds, has divided the church through the flesh and manipulated and controlled weak-minded pastors to bend to their will for money, for power, for whatever. They've been bought with a price other than the blood of Jesus. They've been bought with man's control. So you want to be a follower of Christ. Don't let man control you. Don't let people worry about pleasing people control you. You got to get fervently and get a hold of Christ. You got to get a hold of the Lord. So as an example, let's use a little analogy here. If you had your kid, like me, I said I'm not a great singer. Okay, now people that know my videos, you know my relationship with my family because my family's not really Christian. So I don't have, but lots of people that I know, whether they're Christian or not, they have a great relationship with their family, with their parents and their children and all that. That's awesome. You know, but for me, my family is God and the body of Christ, particularly. Maybe that's why I'm closer to the Lord than lots of people. Maybe, I don't know. I mean, so in that way, it turns out to be a good thing in grace of God, right? And for some of you, same thing. Like the orphans, you know, by God would be their father more so than other people. So anyway, if your child is in a Christmas play or something, right, or some kind of recital, and you go there to see it, and your kid is not really good, lots of people, I've been to those things, and then their kid is like horrible. And they're like, yeah, you know, they clap, they take pictures, they keep grinning, oh, that's my kid, they're so proud. They even show the video of their goofy kid. Somebody, hey, look at my kid, I'm so proud of my kid, right? You know what people do? How much more does our Heavenly Father, who is perfect, Jesus said, love to give good gifts to those who ask. And in Luke chapter 11, he said, how much more you love to give good, you being evil know how to give your children good gifts, Jesus said. How much more your Heavenly Father, who is perfect, love to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask. Luke chapter 11. So, and then in Matthew it says good gifts. The Lord loves to bless us. It says, the Lord just gave me a word for our brother that, and I asked you to pray for our brother Bruce. He's got stomach problems and something wrong with his back. I want you to pray for brother Bruce to be healed. And the Lord gave me a word for him. I had a prayer request for him, and the Lord spoke to me a word. He said, no good thing will God withhold from those who walk up from a man that walks uprightly. I believe that Psalm 84 is the text. Anyway, brothers and sisters, seek the Lord. Seek Him. Just don't be worried about what other people think. Don't be worried about if you look like a fool. Don't worry about if you can't sing good. That's the world. You know, that's what I say. I had a few people that, you know, that messaged me on YouTube said, oh, your singing is not really good. And I know that, but I'm not singing for you. I'm singing for the Lord. If you're singing for people or what you sound like, trying to be some kind of showman, you know, and maybe you'll have, you know, like these rock singers on YouTube, they have millions of views. And some of these showmen on YouTube, they have millions and millions of views. That is nothing. That's the problem with the flesh. Noah had 8 people get on the ark, that's including himself. And then the rest of them was his sons and their wives and his wife. So really, you know, they had to kind of follow him. Noah really didn't have any converts. So according to the world and these people and lots of people on YouTube, oh, that Noah was a failure. Elijah even thought himself was a failure because he thought he was the only one following the Lord and nobody else was. Everybody else was evil but him, but the Lord said, no, I have 7,000 have not bowed the knee to Baal, the God there of Jezebel. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we can never judge success, and I never, that's the secret to my anointing from the Lord. I never judge success by what people think. I never judge success. Now, I'm not, there are people that get on YouTube and they make videos and all they talk in their videos is attacking other people on YouTube. It's not in love, but in hate and evil. As I mentioned before, there's several people that do that. All their videos just bashing people on YouTube for what they say and do, and they disagree with things and they just want to contend and debate with everybody. That's not what we're talking about. Of course, that's also bad. We don't go on here that just want to debate and contend with everybody. That's totally different. But to preach the word of God, they crucified Jesus. I mean, think about it. They killed all the apostles. But one, they tried to burn John in oil, but he survived and wrote the book of Revelation, the Gospel of John, and 1st and 2nd and 3rd John after they tried to boil him in oil. Emperor Domitian of the Roman Empire. So the gospel is an offense to the world. They killed Jesus. Jesus said, no servant is above his master. No, they hated me. They also hate you. So, you know, don't expect the world to love you. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The church is filled with worldly people. The church is filled with... What do you think the devil's going to work at? Does the devil need to go down here and work in the bar? Does the devil need to go work with drug addicts and stuff? No, he's already got them. When I got saved, really got saved, when I was an adult, the first thing I realized is the devil started coming after me. He wasn't bothering me before. You know, or if he was, it was at a low level. But when I got saved, then, you know, and then every time I'm, you know, doing stuff in the ministry and all that, the devil contends with me. Why? Because he's trying to thwart salvations of people. He's trying to thwart the kingdom of God. So his greatest work would be in the church, and even greater work would be in seminaries. The devil's greatest work, especially through the Jesuits have infiltrated all the seminaries of every denomination. They have Jesuit influence. As an example, they're not the only ones. They're just one of the most effective and largest brands of terrorists out there. We've had a great impact. But there's tons of them. Tons of them. The churches are full of demon-possessed and demonized and children of the devil in there to thwart those who are trying to serve the Lord. That's why it's nothing new. You know, that's why these prosperity preachers, of course, I believe God blesses us. And, you know, I'm a Pentecostal preacher, a full gospel preacher. I believe in God blessing us and all that. But if you listen to these prosperity preachers, not only about being a millionaire, they'll tell you that the day you got saved and you'll never have a day another day of trouble in your life. And that is farthest from the truth. Jesus said, in this life you will have tribulation. But behold, I've overcome the world. So we will have tribulation. And when Peter asked him, you know, what about us? We've given up everything to follow you. Jesus said, yeah, you'll have houses. And Jesus said you would have houses and money and all this, whatever he said, all these things that you would have with tribulation. So, yeah, you get the blessings, but you also get the tribulation because the enemy comes in like a flood. God doesn't raise up a standard against the devil and bless you openly in front of your enemies until the enemy comes in like a flood. Then the Lord raises up a standard. Or like in, that's a Bible verse, when the enemy comes in like a flood, I'll lift up a standard against him. And then another, like in the 23rd Psalm, it says, I will prepare a table for you where? In the presence of your enemies. Hey, if you don't have no enemies, then, you know, the whole point is he's going to bless you in front of your enemies. So you have to have enemies. The terrors first, and then he'll bless you in front of them. So they can see, hey, this is God's doing. You know, this is God, so he's provoking them to salvation or whatever is God's doing in all those situations. Why is King David famous? What's the most famous thing that King David is famous for in the world? What does everybody know? He killed Goliath. Without Goliath, David wouldn't have been famous. He became famous in Israel and the national hero of Israel by killing Goliath. So if it wasn't for Goliath, King David wouldn't be famous. So David made Goliath famous. The work of the enemy. What the enemy tried to do, God used it for his glory. Just like, and before he killed the giant, he had killed the lion and the bear. So if it wasn't for the lion and the bear trying to attack him and kill him and attack the sheep, and then the giant, you know, that's what made King David famous and beloved by the people of Israel. Those things. And that's why little children, all little children today, oh yeah, David and Goliath. One of the most, probably the most famous Bible story, David and Goliath. But if it was no Goliath, you wouldn't have a story. There wouldn't have been a victory. You have to have a battle to have a victory. I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, I guess I should retitle this video, you can't have victory without the battle. But the battle is the Lord's. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The victory is, as it says in the 24th Psalm, who will ascend to the mountain of God? Except for him with a clean hands and a pure heart. You got to lift holy hands to God. You know, there's a song that says, I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. He's talking about him praying. You know, calling upon the Lord, fervently seeking God, praise and worship. That's the victory. As I wrote about in the book, I wrote about the story of one of the kings, and then they sent worshipers ahead of the army. And the enemy was, you know, God used angels to destroy the enemy's army because they had praise and worshipers leading the army into battle. I forgot which king it was now. It's in the book. I just thought of it now. It's the power of praise and worship brings the power of God. The Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. Now, you want to be baptized in that Spirit of God? It's in the praises of his people. That's where we receive it from, when we're praising and worshiping and seeking God with a pure, fervent heart. Stop. You get off your agenda. There's people that say, just like Simon, they want to buy the power of the Holy Spirit. There's people, I've met people in the States who asked me to pray with them. Some, I pray with lots of people. I'm not, you know, lots of you guys, I'm not talking about you, okay? But there were some, brothers and sisters, and I know that's always true. But I personally, this trip to the States, there were people who had ulterior motives for being filled with the Holy Spirit. In other words, they just want to play with God's power and all this. It's not with a pure heart. So I asked you to check your motives. And how do you check your motives? Against the Word of God, against the Spirit of God. Like I just made the last video, wrestle with God. And let God lead you and speak to you. The Bible, Romans 8:14, those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the children of God. That's the problem. They were led by their flesh, not by their spirit. You want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? You got to be led by the Spirit, not by the flesh. You got to be led by the Spirit of God and not by your flesh. Get out of your flesh. Feed on the Spirit, not the flesh. Let the flesh starve. Starve your flesh. from the things of this world and feed your spirit with the things of God. God bless you guys. Love you guys. And the Lord chastens whom he loves. God bless.